In the next two videos, we will look at the seventh topic in deep learning, batch normalization of neural networks. In the last video, we used regularization and dropout to prevent overfitting. Batch normalization not only prevents overfitting, but also allows neural networks to learn stably and quickly. This video is part one, and we will look at how batch normalization works during training and during inference or prediction. This video was produced in Korean and translated into English. My voice is AI-generated text-to-speech. Let's take a look at the full table of contents. In the first video, we will look at what the internal covariate shift problem is and how to solve it. And we will look at how batch normalization works during training and during prediction. In the second video, we will look at how the internal parameters of the batch normalization layer change using Keras. And let's implement a batch normalization class from scratch using a Keras custom layer. Finally, let's implement a neural network model with batch normalization using Keras. And let's see the effect. Batch normalization is an algorithm proposed by Sergey Ioff and Christian Jegedy in this paper in 2015. Training deep neural networks is complicated by the fact that the distribution of each layer's inputs changes during training, as the parameters of the previous layers change. This slows down the training by requiring lower learning rates and careful parameter initialization. When the learning rate alpha is set too large, the loss is generally reduced, like this during training. Since alpha is large, the parameters are updated a lot, so the loss decreases quickly. But the variance is large and unstable. When alpha is set small, the loss is generally reduced like this. Since alpha is small, the parameters are updated small, so the deviation is small and stable, but the loss decreases slowly. Therefore, the number of iterations needs to be increased, which slows down the learning speed. In addition, if the initial values of the parameters are simply set randomly, the model can easily fall into a local minimum, which may affect the learning speed. Therefore, the initial values of the parameters also need to be set carefully. We will discuss this in detail in the next topic, weight initialization. The phenomenon in which the input distribution of each layer of a neural network changes is called internal covariate shift. This problem can be solved by normalizing the inputs of each layer. This is the topic of this series, batch normalization. This allows us to use much higher learning rates and be less careful about initialization of parameters. This will make learning faster. It also acts as a regularizer, in some cases eliminating the need for dropout. The idea in this paper is relatively simple. Normalize the inputs to a hidden layer. However, there are a few things to consider during training and prediction. Now let's look at the internal covariate shift problem. A common covariate shift problem is the difference in distribution between the training and test sets, which reduces the predictive performance of the model. These data sets can be processed through important sampling, standardization, or whitening methods during pre-processing. The internal covariate shift is the phenomenon where the input distribution of each layer changes as the parameters of the previous layer change during training. The batches of data are fed into this neural network like this. The first batch of data is entered, followed by the next batch of data in sequence. The input to this layer is H1, and the distribution is like this. Let's call this the distribution of H1 for the first batch of data. The distribution of H1 changes as the parameter W2 changes. The input to this layer is H2, and the distribution is like this. The distribution of H2 changes as the parameter W3 changes. The distribution of H1 has a mean of this point and a variance of this much. The distribution of H2 has a mean of this point and a variance much smaller than that of H1. This change in the input distribution of each layer is called the internal covariate shift problem. As W3 changes, the distribution of H2 may also change like this. In some cases, data from this distribution will be fed into this layer. And in other cases, data from this distribution will be fed into this layer. Then this layer will have difficulty learning. This problem can be addressed by normalizing the inputs of each layer during training and prediction. Now let's see how batch normalization works during training. We have a simple neural network like below, and we apply the batch normalization to the hidden layer. These neurons consist of the part that adds all the inputs, and the part that applies an activation function. Batch normalization is a kind of layer that sits between these two parts. Data X is fed into this neural network. X is a batch of data and is a M by D matrix. M is the batch size of the data. And D is the number of features. The weights DH is a D by K matrix. K is the number of neurons in this hidden layer. Then the output of this part will be the matrix H, which is the dot product of X and WA. We don't need to use bias here. We'll see why in a moment. H is a M by K matrix. In the batch normalization layer, the matrix H is normalized. The result is the matrix R. Matrix R is the output of the batch normalization layer. When we apply an activation function F to the matrix R, it becomes the output of the hidden layer. Now let's look at how to normalize H. In this way, we normalize each element of matrix H using the Z-score formula. We denote the normalized H as H hat. Here, the E of HJ is the mean of each column of matrix H. This is expressed in Python code as follows. And the var of HJ is also the variance of each column of matrix H. Epsilon is a small number to avoid the denominator becoming zero. This is the same way we normalize data in the pre-processing step. Since data X is fed in batches, the normalization is also performed in batches. That is, the mean and variance of HJ continue to vary depending on the data X. Next, let's look at how to find the matrix R. Each element of matrix R is computed as follows. Here, gamma J is a variable that scales H hat, and H hat is the normalized H. beta j corresponds to a bias. We are using the bias here, so we don't need to use a bias here. Gamma and beta are trainable parameters and are determined through training. The initial value of gamma can be set to 1, and the initial value of beta can be set to 0. These are updated using gradient descent during error backpropagation. The gamma j can be updated using the gradient of loss L with respect to gamma j as follows. The same goes for beta j. Let's look at why we use gamma and beta. H hat is normalized, so its mean and variance are 0 and 1 respectively. And let's assume that the activation function of this hidden layer is sigmoid. Let's assume that the distribution of H hat looks like this, with mean of 0 and variance of 1. If we apply the sigmoid activation function to H hat, the output will be approximately linear. Then the nonlinearity effect of the hidden layer disappears. The variance needs to be somewhat large for the nonlinear effect to occur. How big it needs to be is determined through learning. That's what gamma does. Beta controls the position of the mean. During training, exponential moving averages for E of H and var of H are computed and stored. These are used to normalize H for the test data during prediction. Rho is a hyperparameter. The larger rho reflects more past E of H, and the smaller rho reflects more recent E of H. For Keras batch normalization layer, the default value of rho is 0.99. It gives a weight of 0.99 to the past E of H, and a weight of 0.01 to the recent E of H. If there is a second hidden layer on top of this, and when we apply batch normalization to this layer, the same process is performed on this layer as well. Next, let's look at the prediction process. Once this neural network is trained, the gamma, beta, and the exponential moving average and variance for H in the batch normalization layer are determined. Gamma and beta are trained parameters used in this formula during training. Mu EMA and sigma EMA are calculated and stored using this formula during training. During prediction, these values are used to normalize the H values of the test data. Test data X is fed into this neural network. N is the number of test data points, and D is the number of features. The matrix H is computed in the hidden layer using this formula. K is the number of neurons in the hidden layer. We use this formula to compute H hat, the normalization of each element of matrix H. The mean and variance used here are the exponential moving average and variance that were saved during training. We do not recompute the mean and variance of the matrix H computed from the test data. This is equivalent to using the mean and variance of the training data when normalizing the test data during pre-processing. We use the normalized H to calculate the matrix R using this formula. Gamma and beta were trained during training. If we apply an activation function to the matrix R, this will be the output of this hidden layer. The final output for this test data is y hat. This is the prediction process of a neural network with batch normalization applied. So far, we have seen how batch normalization works in the training and prediction stage. In the next video, we will implement batch normalization.